Either two ways we encourage more farmers to plant more trees are we help with cost and we help with information. We know that the impacts that climate change will have on our rain is that instead of having kind of soft, gentle rain every day, we get these really intense downpours. The number of breaks that we can put in, the number of interruptions that we can put in between that rain kind of coming down from the sky and that rain hitting the ground, the better. So, you know, protein is really important for people to have access to. Then having access to things like nuts to replace those proteins in our diet becomes quite key. So we need to find a way of funding more farmers to plant trees that includes more commercial trees because they're still of public benefit and that doesn't penalise farmers if they're not successful. I'm Harriet Bell, I'm the Regenerative Farming Lead for Riverford Organic Farmers. In a time of climate crisis, there are a lot of good reasons to plant more trees. I think for me, the big motivation behind planting trees, and particularly where you're planting them in an agroforestry system or a forest garden system, is just that it can deliver like at least five good things that you want to happen. And yes, some of that might be about stopping climate change, like the carbon, but it's also about how we build in our resilience to deal with climate change. We know that the impacts that climate change will have on our rain is that instead of having kind of soft, gentle rain every day, we get these really intense downpours and they can cause a lot of problems with the soil, mostly because they wash the soil off down the hill and dump it somewhere further down. And so the number of breaks that we can put in, the number of interruptions that we can put in between that rain kind of coming down from the sky and that rain hitting the ground, the better. And the reverse of that is that when we experience drought stress, the trees can help bring more water up. And if we're looking at how climate change is going to affect the UK, the availability of water is probably the number one impact that we are likely to see and we have seen in recent years. Permanent or perennial food crops could be critically important where we see weather events really affecting our shorter term annual crops. Livestock really benefit from the protection of trees in a kind of climate change era. This is a field on Riverford's wash farm, and this is what we would call a silver pasture system. So that's trees in amongst grass for animals to eat, in this case the Riverford dairy herd. Now these are a particular type of trees, these are walnut trees, so they're delivering multiple functions, but we've specifically picked walnuts because they also provide us with a food crop. So protein is really important for people to have access to. We actually consume a reasonable amount in this country of nut protein, but most of it's imported. We grow very little of our own, and also if we're phasing out other sources of protein that might be more environmentally challenging, then having access to things like nuts to replace those proteins in our diet becomes quite key. So trees are really important for helping build soil carbon, helping access nutrients and minerals kind of below the soil surface and bringing them up so they can be accessed by other plants. They also feed soil carbon through leaf dropping and other processes as well. But they also do things like slow the flow of wind, and wind can really dehydrate other crops. Obviously, we might see increasing extreme weather events where wind's a factor, so slowing the flow of wind as it hits other features in the landscape could be important. But there's one key significant element I would suggest as to why agroforestry hasn't taken off more in this country. And it's to do with the high level of diversity of options of every single sort of stage of the process, which means that even the existing agroforestry projects, you can't exactly pick them up as a template and just transfer them across and apply them to your land. It's what you need to understand about your soil type, about your climate, about your aspects, about the tree itself, about how all of that might change as we go through climate change, about whether or not you've got available irrigation, whether you need available irrigation. There's just a lot of huge amount of burden in terms of acquiring knowledge and skills around tree planting and tree management in order to even vaguely feel like you can proceed with confidence. And even then, It's without sort of travelling several years down the road, you might not be entirely certain that it succeeded. So we're actually standing in kind of quite a good example. So this, this is just a small demo site really, but what it does is it gives you an idea of the kind of diversity of different elements involved. So this isn't probably going to be grazed because it's on a demo site with a garden next door. It will probably just be cut. So technically it's probably a silver arable system, even though it's trees planted into very permanent pasture. And what we've got here is we've got a diversity of different trees. Now, some of these trees people will be really familiar with, and there'll be lots of examples of where they've been used in agroforestry systems. So we have walnuts in this planting and we have hazelnuts in this planting. Now, there is a lot of information out there, admittedly, usually from other countries, about how to grow hazelnuts or how to grow walnuts in an agroforestry system. So the element of uncertainty is about finding out about those international models and looking at how you translate them to this country, but also what's going to work well in terms of harvesting, what's going to be easy to harvest, what is going to translate well into a product for the UK market. So even those two familiar trees bring a lot of complexity in terms of decision making and selection with them. But then we've got trees here that will be less familiar to people in the UK. So in here somewhere, we've got Szechuan pepper, which is a native tree to China. It's a very high value spice tree, but it's not exactly grown in this part of the world. So most people won't have someone just down the road that they can go to and say, oh, can I just pick your brain about how to plant, grow and harvest Szechuan pepper in England, please? Because it's not done. Nobody's doing it. So there's no friendly neighbour to turn to and say, oh, am I getting this quite right? Whereas there is with other crops, the crops that we're familiar with in this country and the crops that most farmers grow. And some people are lucky. They might have really good people around them that they can turn to for advice, whether those are kind of foresters or gardeners or even sort of on-farm advisors. But that is not necessarily available to everybody. And also, because of the siloed nature of knowledge, sometimes it can be hard to find someone who could advise you on every aspect. So you might have somebody who's really good at forestry, who's not going to be able to give you the best of advice about how trees that could translate into an a silver arable system or an agroforestry system, because they won't necessarily be able to translate their knowledge of trees from forestry to understanding what the impact could be on your arable crop, for example. And of course, one of the significant barriers to establishing more trees is largely around cost. If you want to opt for a tree that's maybe a kind of more productive part of your farm system in terms of providing you with a crop rather than a kind of environmental benefit, that can be a bit more challenging. Those trees are often far more expensive, so they might be between, say, £7.50 to £22.50. They might require sort of planting in a much wider spacing and therefore guarding individually, and particularly if you're guarding against livestock, that can add significant costs. And there is often likely to be less support available for them because they're seen as a commercial product. So you're going to see less sort of charities funding them, perhaps maybe less availability through government stewardship schemes, which arguably makes sense because you're growing them for a crop. But actually, if you consider that in the context of sort of we as a society doing more to embrace agroforestry and sort of sharing the learning around agroforestry, around tree planting, it doesn't really make sense because it can be a very high risk project. Farming and forestry have really been segregated as different skill sets, sort of different government departments for advice and funding and support, and registered as sort of totally different land uses. So we were at a point, even up until recently, where farmers were penalised if they had too many trees in their fields. So their financial benefit that they received from government, the subsidy scheme that they received from government, was reduced. And it's probably disincentivise people who consider themselves farmers from getting more to grips with sort of establishing and planting woodland or other forms of on-farm trees. We are seeing movement on that, and we have seen movement on that in recent years. So we started to see a relaxation of the kind of number of trees that you could be permitted to have on your land and still receive your basic farm payment in recent years. We've seen DEFRA commit to developing an agroforestry option for elm, which is the new environmental land management scheme, although we haven't seen the detail of that yet. I think we're presuming that it's still likely to happen in 2024, but we still don't know in what shape and what form. We've seen sort of more options coming into the existing countryside stewardship scheme that supports tree planting. And we've seen new offers like the English Woodland Creation Offer to help support more trees being established. That actually it is still incredibly important that even when we're planting trees that are viewed as a kind of commercial crop, particularly if it's a food crop, that there is available support through government subsidy schemes to get them going and established. So for me, the two ways we encourage more farmers to plant more trees are we help with cost and we help with information. And I think information, it's about doing the research. So for example, I am a huge believer in using trees as a fodder crop for livestock for their health and well-being benefit, massively under-researched. And even more importantly, it's then how we take that information when we do have it and we put it in a really easy, accessible, super easy to kind of take and apply template for farmers. So dealing with cost is one of the other ways that we can really help farmers establish more trees on their farms. So as part of our Refer a Friend scheme here at Riverford, we've been paying the full upfront costs for farmers establishing trees. So we've been buying the tree, we've been paying for the guards that go on the tree, and we've been paying for the labour to get that tree in the ground. And that can be quite expensive. We are confident but not necessarily certain of a future market for those trees, which makes shouldering that cost quite a significant risk for most farms. There's also the possibility that due to no fault of their own, there might be a force majeure event, like the big drought that we had this summer, that has a significant impact on the likelihood of those trees succeeding. So we need to find a way of funding more farmers to plant trees that includes more commercial trees because they're still of public benefit and that doesn't penalise farmers if they're not successful, because A, that failure might be outside of their control, and B, it should be something that we use as a collective learning about how to deliver agroforestry in this country. It's great that we're seeing a government with an appetite for funding more trees on farms, but it's not enough to fund the trees themselves. We really need to get out there and give people the advice on things like pruning and ongoing management that makes people feel confident that they have the skills to look after these trees, to make them a really successful, viable part of their farm business.